Living Lord Jesus, walk amongst us. We need you. We need you to reveal yourself to us. So please, in your mercy, take my lips and speak through them. Take our minds and think through them. Take our wills and bend them to your own. Take our hearts, Lord Jesus, and set them on fire with love for yourself. You know what state we have come in. And you know what we need to hear from you and what you need to do for us. And thank you that you are a living and loving Lord Jesus. And may it be of your good pleasure to meet us and roll back the boulders in our lives that get between us and you. We pray this for your name's sake. Amen. You may know the name Annie Dillard if you're into literary stuff and you're a real Pittsburgher and a Yunzer. You will know the name Annie Dillard because she's a Pittsburgh lady and actually a world famous author. And in her book, Teaching a Stone to Talk, she spoke about a traditional church on an Easter morning in these terms. She said, on the whole, I do not find Christians outside of the catacombs, that's where they were in suffering and persecution in Rome in the first century, outside the catacombs sufficiently sensible of conditions. Does anyone have the foggiest idea what sort of power we so blithely invoke? Or, as I suspect, does no one believe a word of it? That would be a little bit harsh for us this morning. The churches are children on the floor playing with their chemistry sets, mixing up a batch of TNT to kill off a Sunday morning. It is madness, nothing to do with you ladies wearing them, it is madness to wear ladies' straw hats and velvet hats to church. We should all be wearing crash helmets. Ushers should issue life preservers and signal flares. They should lash us to our pews. For the sleeping God may yet awake someday and take offense. Or the waking God may draw us out of where we The waking God may draw us out to where we can never return. And that's the observation of like traditional Easter people in church, nicely dressed, going through rituals and motions and words, but without any impact on their lives or anybody else's. So that's what she's after. Now, in contrast to that, let me describe an Easter some years ago when I was pastor at another church. And you see how beautifully all these lilies are arranged here. And I do want to say thank you for all of you who have memorialized people via these lilies and the ladies who put this all together. It's magnificent. Well, the lady in this church where I was pastoring was doing the altar arrangement. And she was really into arranging flowers. And so she told her grown daughter, who was a lawyer, single, grown, lawyer daughter, that she was doing the flowers on the Lord's table and she'd like her to come and see them. So that got the daughter to church on Easter Sunday to see her mother's floral arrangement. She came as a skeptic. She didn't come to worship. She didn't come to sing. She didn't come to hear the sermon. She came to see her mother's flowers. But that day, Jesus Christ met her, and she left that church an absolutely transformed woman. It was not church as usual. She wasn't just looking at flowers anymore. And she gave me a call, and I was stunned to hear it, because lawyers are pretty tough stuff. They're trained skeptics. But Christ had broken through in her life. She had an experience of Jesus and went out of the church like she was walking on air, as if she were glowing herself. Now, for some of you here this morning, that's going to happen. So you're here. And it is Easter. But it won't be Easter as usual. And you will leave here radically transformed by the Spirit of the living God at work in you. Now, if you turn to page 6 in your service sheet, that's that other document you receive, that will bring you to Luke chapter 24 and the first section of that chapter. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They were really going to complete a funeral. Because of another holy day coming up on the Friday when he was executed, Friday, the Sabbath begins in the evening. The first day is Friday evening. The Jewish day goes from the evening, sunset, to the next day. So, because Jesus died on Friday afternoon, they didn't have time to properly embalm him before the Sabbath began. So he was hastily laid in somebody else's tomb. And he was wrapped, all right, but he wasn't embalmed. So they were coming with the spices to finish the job on the first day of the week, after the Sabbath. So that was Sunday morning, that they were coming really early to finish this funeral. And when they got there, as you know, they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. And when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. Now, that stone was not rolled away to let Jesus out or to get Jesus out. The stone was rolled away to let the women in, so that others could come and see that Jesus was gone. The grave clothes were there. Jesus didn't need the stone rolled away. You know, like Beam Me Up Scotty. He could demolecularize and reshape and reform with his resurrection body. Just put this in parenthesis. You know and love Jesus, you're going to get one of those bodies one day. And you can turn up all over the place like, wow, how'd that happen? And kids, that's dangerous. Because mom or dad will suddenly be there. And you'll say, oh my goodness, because they caught you. That would be tough, wouldn't it? So, if you've got Jesus able to do this, because you remember later, he turns up where the disciples are locked up in a room for fear of the opposition, and suddenly, Jesus is there. He didn't sneak in through the door. He didn't drop down through the ceiling. He was there. So the stone was rolled away to let us see in that Jesus was no longer there. Well, while they're in there looking, two angels turn up. That's what it goes on to tell you. And they ask this question. Why do you look for the living among the dead? Do you see that at the close of verse 5? Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Now, the resurrection of Jesus, no longer there, no longer dead, no longer in the tomb. Jesus alive is such an overwhelming, powerful truth that the whole of the Christian faith and indeed our human destiny is focused on that reality. Let me put it in these terms. We're going to be looking at three things. Number one, that Jesus walking from the grave gives us a word of truth we can trust in. Secondly, Jesus walking from the grave alive gives to us a Savior we can trust in. And thirdly, Jesus walking from the grave alive gives us a hope that we can trust in. A truth, a word of truth, a statement of truth, a document of truth, truth that you can trust in. A real Savior that you can trust in. And a hope that will never let you down, that you can trust in. Look at what's said here. The angel, having asked that question, why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, he is risen. Went on to say, remember how he told you, while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day be raised again. And then it says, then they remembered his words. When you read the Gospels, any number of times Jesus told his followers, I am going to be rejected, I'm going to be executed, crucified, and I'm going to walk from the grave alive. And in their grief and in the swiftness with which it all happened, because one minute he's riding into Jerusalem on the donkey, and next he's executed on a cross in agony. And before you know it, he's laid out in this tomb, without time to really give him a proper funeral. And before you know it, they get to the tomb and it's empty and he's gone and angels are talking to them. And reminding them that in the swiftness of all this, something they had forgotten. That what had happened to Jesus, he had told them would happen. They didn't want to hear it. They fought it. They shut their minds to it. But the angel came and reminded them. That would say to me that in all probability, the angel was around at the time Jesus was doing all this teaching, watching over and protecting the Lord until it was his time. Because the angel was giving the message. The angel saying, don't you remember? This is what he told you. So either the angel was there or the Lord just gave him the message to repeat. And I take a pretty good shot at thinking that the angel was there. So, don't you remember? And they did remember. Jesus told them that it was going to happen. And it happened as he said it would. But later in this chapter, you're not going to be able to find this in your service sheet. But in chapter, that same chapter 24, verse 25, he's now breezing along with two other disciples who are mumbling to each other about the terrible things that had happened in Jerusalem, talking about Jesus. They're walking from Jerusalem to a little town called Emmaus, and there are two of them talking with each other, and Jesus kind of starts walking along with them, so there's three of them now. He's kind of come from nowhere. They don't recognize him as Jesus for whatever reason. And he's saying, what are you talking about? And they said, are you a visitor to Jerusalem? You don't know what's just gone on in the last days? And they tell him, they tell Jesus. There was this Jesus we hoped would be the one who'd redeem Israel. But he was taken and executed. And now some women tell us this amazing story this morning that they went to the tomb and angels told them that Jesus wasn't there, he was risen. And they're already leaving Jerusalem, this two, talking about it. And Jesus says to them, and this is what again is so powerful. Let me quote him. How foolish you are, how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter into glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. What he is doing is taking this word, this book, the Bible, and explaining it to them. It's Jesus himself. He's not just saying, I told you. He's saying, The prophets told you. Moses told you. And then later on, he's with all the disciples, and they're gathered around, and he says to them again, and this is verse 45, he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures, and he told them, this is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem, and you are witness of these things. They had gotten to witness what the prophets had told them would happen. So when I say to you, you've got a word that you can trust, in this kind of post-Christian, post-modern era, it's hard to know what to believe of what anybody says anymore. And young adults are weary of being jerked around by advertising and the manipulation of this or that and the spin, as it's called. And it's like you don't know what to trust anymore. And Jesus walking out of the grave alive. And what he said here concerning his word tells you there is a word that you can trust. It's his word. So amongst all the confusion, this is the place to come back to. And for those of you who struggle with this, let me challenge you to go and read the gospel straight through. That's not a big deal. You're readers. You know how to read. Read the gospel straight through. And it's absolutely stunning. I defy you to come out the other end of reading those gospels and be a skeptic about what you have read. Because it is so authenticating. And there's another thing that happens while you're reading that. And I'm telling you this by faith, that the Spirit of God takes that truth and unfolds it to you in the same way Jesus unfolded it to his disciples. Wouldn't you love to be on a Bible study with Jesus telling you what it means? Instead of some goofy preacher, you've got Jesus. My wife and I were talking about this week. And we came up with this idea. How about a walking, talking Bible study? Instead of having to sit in rows and somebody tell you, kind of breeze along together and talk about what the scripture says. Kathy said that would be really great because when women walk together for exercise, they tend to talk about other women or other people. That's my wife telling me this. How would I know? She said, I like to walk by myself because I'd rather just talk to the Lord than hear what's going on with other people's lives. So get yourself some walking, talking Bible studies. And then resist the idea of saying, oh, I can see the way this scripture really would apply to this lady. You know, you can turn it into gossip real fast, if you know, because I know how to do that too. Anyway, to have Jesus unfold the scriptures. Some of you really have got something like a great boulder across your mind. And some angel's got to come and roll that away and let the Spirit of God breathe some life. It's interesting to me that the angel asked the question, why do you seek the living among the dead? It's so easy to go looking at dead teaching, dead philosophies, dead ideas. When you have the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, and you have a Lord who's walked out of the grave alive, why do you go fussing around with any other kind of philosophy or teaching? Really, what you're doing is rummaging around amongst the dead, looking for life. God's given us a sure word. Go to it. Secondly, a Savior you can trust. Here is the angel speaking about Jesus saying that he must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, this is verse 7, and be crucified. Now, of course, this is like just within days of, you've got to get this, within days of Jesus being at the Last Supper, and not just talking about his dying, but telling us what his dying meant. He took the cup of wine and he gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant," a new agreement, in other words, between people and God. "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." And when Jesus was explaining his dying to those disciples, of course, you can just quickly go by. He explained to them that because of his death on the cross, salvation would be preached with repentance to the whole of the world, beginning at Jerusalem. That's preaching Christ as having died to pay the penalty for our sins, to become our Savior, to become the Lamb of God, the sacrificial Lamb who takes away the sin of the world. That through Christ's death on the cross, we can be forgiven and made new and clean and begin a new life. Sin is what screws everything up here on earth. Sin in a family. Sin in relationships with friends. Sin where we work. In our schools. On the streets. In the media. Sin makes everything a mess. Could you ever imagine a world without sin? Where kids don't knife each other in the back. Where husbands don't desert wives, or wives husbands. Half the kids in America today are growing up in single parent homes. They don't celebrate that. Stuff that's going on screws everything up. Can you imagine what the world would be like if there were no sin? There'd be no policemen. There'd be no jails. There'd be no lawyers. How good is that? You'd have homes as they were meant to be. Children regarding their parents as they were meant to do. Parents loving and raising their children as they were meant to. Work. Wouldn't it be great to go to work and everybody cheering you on, thrilled to see you, and you get at it? How? That would be unbelievable. That would be great for most pastors to turn up in church where the congregation's cheering them on. That's the experience we have here. You are an unbelievable congregation of people, and you cheer us on so we can go for it. But I know pastors who've been whipped and beaten and crawl out of there barely with their lives by Christian people, in quotes. It's not a good deal. And that in Jesus Christ, we have a Savior who has taken that all on himself. And to authenticate that, it wasn't like he just sort of went to a chalkboard and erased all the bad stuff against you. It cost him. He laid down his life. He was impaled upon the cross. He died in agony. And then the cup of all the evil and wickedness of the world, he drank and paid the penalty and the price of everything that we have ever done wrong to be our Savior. And to be able to trust that Savior. That's what happened to that woman I described earlier. It wasn't just that she met a living Jesus who walked from the grave alive. She met a living Savior who made her whole life new and dealt with all the garbage of her past and gave her a new power to live into the future. So thirdly then, a hope that you can trust. That is the hope of a real heaven. To get that squared away, to know where this all leads. To know that in Jesus Christ walking from the grave alive, he authenticated his death on the cross so that you could know that you've got a Savior. Listen to me. Have you ever thought of this? If Jesus did not walk from the grave alive, you would not have known that he died on the cross. The only reason you know he died on a cross, or even that there was crucifixion in, for the most part, is because of Jesus. The Romans executed tens of thousands of people by crucifixion, lined highways with them, had them as ornaments in gardens where they were having parties, covered with tar and set on fire. You can only name two other people, if you think quickly, who've ever been crucified. One is Peter, who was crucified upside down in Rome, and the other is Spartacus, who Kirk Douglas played 100 years ago when he was a young stud. And Jean Simmons was the woman who wept while he died on the cross. My wife saw that as a teenager, that movie, so that'll take you back about 40 years. About that time, that's about right. Well, I married a younger woman. I could have said 50 or 60 years and that would have been me. Don't you be moaning at me. Come on now. But she wept. She went to the movie and wept. And all they're doing is acting, killing Spartacus. It wasn't even Jesus. And there's only Kirk Douglas. Name another one. Who got executed on the cross? You're cooked. You have no idea. The only reason you know about it is because Jesus walked from the grave alive. And in walking from the grave alive, it demonstrates that when he died on the cross, he really did die for your sins so that you can be forgiven and have your home in heaven. Because it's sin that gets between us and getting to heaven. And God's not going to take all this sinful garbage that represents our lives and just transport it to heaven and mess up heaven the way we've messed up earth. It's not going to happen. So we need to come to Christ and be forgiven and made new and clean. That's why the Bible speaks about being born again, being made new, being a new creation. The old things have passed away and everything is made new. And here's what's extraordinary. To know that heaven really is your home tells you the rest of the story of your life. You sometimes hear it said that people are so heavenly minded, they're no earthly use. I've heard that said. So heavenly minded, they're no earthly use. C.S. Lewis turned that around. He said, the reality is that most people are so earthly minded, they're no heavenly use. Listen to this. For Christians, the vision of worldly power is not a calling, but a distraction. It is a temptation Jesus rejected, not because it was dangerous, but because it was trivial. Compared with his mission, C.S. Lewis had it right. To quote him, if you read history, you will find that the Christians who did most for the present world were just those who thought most about the next. The apostles themselves who set on foot the conversion of the Roman Empire, the great men who built up the Middle Ages, the English evangelicals who abolished the slave trade, all left their mark on earth precisely because their minds were occupied with heaven. It is since Christians have largely ceased to think about the other world that they have become so ineffective in this one. Aim at heaven and you will get earth thrown in. Aim at earth and you will get neither. And it's true. So to know heaven is your home, and to be heavenly minded, and to have your hearts fixed on things that are above, not on things on earth. To have our minds and our outlooks transformed by the bigger picture of heaven is extraordinary, because it gives you hope that it's all headed somewhere. For all the disasters and wickedness in this world. It's fantastic. I mean, to think that, and I remember saying at one of the other services, listen, if there were no sin, what would the newspapers write about? CNN would be out of business. Fox News would be cooked. It'd be all over, would it? Because all they'd have was good news to tell about. And they say, that doesn't sell. It does. It sells to us, doesn't it? Don't you want to hear good news? I don't want to hear any more bad news. I kind of like, don't why tune it out. I do not want to deal with bad news. Because it just comes at you like an avalanche. So to be so heavenly minded that we can be some earthly use to the Lord. Back in 1990... So what are we talking about there? 16 years ago, I was going into Russia with a team of Americans to do a preaching campaign in Russia. Gorbachev was still running the show. It was still a communist country, but they were experimenting with glasnost. This is like almost ancient history now. Kids are learning of it in school. The Berlin Wall was coming down, and we were beginning to go into, the West was going into, these previously closed Soviet nations and preaching the good news of Jesus. And we had shipped from Finland, which was the closest free nation, to Moscow, a huge PA system that you could hear like half a mile away. And we went preaching the gospel on Arbat Street in Moscow. And one Sunday afternoon, we had a concert and preaching in Gorky Park. And I was fascinated because I saw the movie Gorky Park and I read the book Gorky Park. And now here I am with my PA system and a whole team of Americans and a huge crowd of Russians from Moscow. And my preaching the gospel through this PA system following a guy who did a concert for us. And how do you communicate to an atheistic, locked up society all the truths of the gospel that you want to get out there so quickly? Because it's not like you're going to be there for 3 hours. And then I remembered being in Red Square that morning. And there was a long line waiting to see Lenin's dead body in his tomb. Lenin was vacuum packed, like in a glass coffin with all the air sucked out of it. He was embalmed, and there he was vacuum packed for you to see, sort of elevated to look up and see Lenin. And as I'm preaching to this audience in the park, and I've got my big PA system, and I kind of lean into the microphone and I say, Lenin is dead. I saw them lining up to see his dead body. Because this gets translated into Russian. There's another guy gets up to the microphone and says it in Baruski. I said, Jesus is alive. And the place got quiet. I said it again, only louder. Lenin is dead. Jesus is alive. I want to tell you something. The birds stopped singing. I mean, it got like quiet. And then I screamed out through this PA system, Lenin is dead. Jesus is alive. And that Russian audience jumped to its feet and started applauding. Now, what do you think that was about? Maybe because Lenin was dead, really dead. They had just discovered that there was a heaven. In other words, Jesus walking from the grave alive. gave meaning and purpose to life. They didn't have their grubby little tenement apartments with their grubby little jobs in their grubby little lines for their grubby little rations and going to their grubby little desks and getting buried in a grubby little hole. And that's it. That's what they've been taught. If Jesus is alive, then this life means something and is headed somewhere. And here they are coming out of whatever their 70-year history is of atheism, and they are applauding, standing and applauding. And here we sit. It's fun to hear it, isn't it? But you should be on your feet. Jesus is alive. Lenin is dead. And so all the dead philosophers and their philosophies and all those means by which we get distracted and others go looking amongst the dead rather than coming to Christ and finding the living truth of the gospel. Let's bow our heads and pray together here. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for being here this morning. Thank you for being real to us. Just as we've spoken of it, Lord, for those who have a mind that's veiled from the truth, tear that curtain from top to bottom, Lord Jesus, and come visit them and refresh them and renew them and set them on fire with love for you. Thank you, Lord, for this word that we can trust. Thank you for being our Savior who we can deeply trust. And thank you for a hope that will never fail us. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, for one or two of you, you need to deal with the Lord here this morning. This is a moment for you that I don't want you to miss. So as you sit there, see yourself in the presence of this Lord Jesus, his coming to you as he came to Thomas or the people on the highway. He's looking at you, loving you. I trust that he has been making real to you and vital to you these words from his word. If you want to know for sure that heaven is your home and that this Lord Jesus really is your Savior, then you need to speak to him and ask him to come and take over your life. So let me speak on your behalf. While you look at Jesus, you take my words and make them your own in your own heart. Say to him, "Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for loving me. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. Thank you for walking from the grave alive for me. And thank you for coming to visit me here this morning. Come into my life, Lord Jesus, I surrender to you. Forgive me all my skepticisms. Forgive me, Lord, that I've believed my doubts rather than your word. Forgive me, Lord, that I've gone looking elsewhere than to you. Today, right now, right here, Lord Jesus, I ask you to come into my life. Forgive me all my sins, and including my sin of unbelief. Fill me with your Spirit. Living Lord Jesus, come and dwell in me. And according to your promise, make me a new creation. Give me a new beginning, a new focus in my life, and something worthwhile to live for. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen."
You've been listening to a message delivered by Dr. John Guest, the pastor of Christ Church at Grove Farm in Sewickley, Pennsylvania. Christ Church meets at 249 Duff Road in Sewickley, and we'd love to have you join us. For service times and information, call us at area code 412-741-4900. That's 412-741-4900. You may also contact us at that number if you have a spiritual need or question. Christ Church is dedicated to reaching out to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with the world around us, to help us grow in our faith, and to find our personal ministry. Thank you for listening.
So may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up the light of His countenance upon you. Grant you His rest, His peace. So may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be amongst you and go with you and bless you. All God's people said, Amen.